Great. So thanks to Dr. Greenberg and Dr. Blake for inviting me to be here today and give you an example from HINTS-FDA, which, as was reiterated, is available internally and will be available publicly too. Again, my name is Bessie Donaldson. I'm a social scientist in the Office of Science at FDA. And so I'll be providing an example in STATA because that's the program I know best. So for those of you new to STATA, hopefully this will introduce you to some of the comparisons between the programs you've heard about earlier. For those that already know STATA, this may be a bit of a refresher or just a reminder of how to work in HINTS with STATA. Perfect. So this is an overview of my presentation. I'll briefly introduce HINTS-FDA since it's a little bit different in terms of the sampling strategy than previous cycles of HINTS. I'll give you some general tips for working in STATA with these data, and then I'm going to walk through an example that I'm working on currently with colleagues at NCI and FDA in these data. And throughout, I'll provide some sample STATA commands and output examples. So I've tried to focus this presentation on those of you who may be new to secondary data analysis and or new to working in STATA, and so that's kind of the framework I've used. If you want more specific information about the example I'm providing, feel free to ask at the end or come up after, and there is a manuscript planned, so there'll be more information coming out specifically about this analysis. So this is an overview of HINTS-FDA. So it was a special round of HINTS data collection conducted by the National Cancer Institute through an interagency agreement with the Food and Drug Administration. And so it combines the traditional HINTS topics that we've seen in other cycles with additional questions about risk perceptions about tobacco products and tobacco product claims. Data were collected between May and September 2015. And there's a key difference in that the sampling strategy attempted to oversample for current smokers or for smokers in general. So the way it did this is it used data from the Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance System and looked at county-level smoking rates and addressed that and put that into sampling strata based on high, medium low, and low smoking rates. And then the high and medium high strata were then oversampled to increase the yield of smokers. And the response rate was 3,738 overall, so about 33% response rate. The yield of current smokers was a bit lower than anticipated, so it didn't fully achieve that, but the sampling strategy did achieve the goal of former smokers. So this is the example I'll walk through. It's an example looking at the relationship between media exposure and beliefs about the addictiveness of tobacco products. And I'm working with Dr. Kelly Blake here at NCI, Dr. Isabella Zandberg, and Dr. Allison Hoffman at FDA. And again, these analyses are far from final, but I wanted to give you a snapshot here of what we're doing to give you some specific examples of these data. So this is our analytic objective here, to explore beliefs about the addictiveness of tobacco products and to examine whether media exposure, both the general exposure, so hours you're watching television, internet, or radio, as well as content of that information, so have you been exposed to messages about the health effects of tobacco on various media sources, is that associated with the respondents' beliefs about addictiveness of these products? So these are two of the questions that we used from HINTS-FDA, so you'll see that when those questionnaires become public. And this is kind of stepping away from the example for a minute, just for those of you who are new to STATA, to show you what it looks like in case it's completely new to you, and to just tell you that STATA, similar to other programs, has several components. So here I've pictured the output window here, and then over here is my do file. So basically, in working in STATA, you have a do file, which, as would suggest, is where you're telling STATA what to do. You're writing your commands, and then you'll have a log file that you'll typically save, which will keep a log of both the commands that you've told STATA to do, as well as the output. A helpful note that I like to do in my do files is to use an asterisk to write notes to myself. So when you come back from a do file, from being away for a little bit, it's like, hey, you know, make a log file, and that's what I'm doing in the subsequent command. So that's something I like to do quite a bit. This is what the actual HINTS-FDA data looks like for the variables of interest in this analysis. These are the questions about addictive beliefs about various products, cigarettes, cigars, smokeless, and others. Another note that kind of was addressed in differences between data sets is that missing values in different programs need to be coded different ways. In STATA, they're coded as a dot. And so the code book and the methodology report are great resources to go through and see, as Allie and others mentioned, what is coded as missing. So down here you can see -9 was coded for some of these, and so then I go ahead and recode those into a dot. So again, these are weighted data, and so this is the, I think this follows nicely from Dr. Moser's presentation and how you would tell STATA to do jackknife replicate weight. So STATA, unlike perhaps other programs, the way that you set it up is you have this line of command, the SV set command, where you're basically telling STATA that whenever I say SVY as a prefix, that I want you to go back and refer to these replicate weights. And so that's how it's provided here, and it is provided in the analytic resources. So then when you do subsequent commands, when you create a 2x2 table, do logistic regression, you just do SVY jack. So the default in STATA is Taylor linearization. So if you just put SVY, that's the weighting that it would do. So that wouldn't work in HINTS data. So you want to make sure you have that jack in there. And if you're new to using survey commands in STATA, STATA has great help commands. So if you just type help SVY, it will give you a whole list of commands to work from. And this just shows you the difference between the unweighted or raw estimates in STATA, and then I'll show you the weighted estimates. So here you can see our sample size was 3,738. And you can see for this question about the beliefs about the addictiveness of cigarette smoking that a majority of respondents, almost 79%, said that cigarette smoking was very addictive. And this is the weighted data here. So again, you see I use the SVY jack command. I also asked for the standard errors and the confidence intervals. You can see up here the sample size, the number of respondents, and how it's weighting by applying jackknife replicate weighting up to over 200 million respondents. So before I get into this, I did want to note too, and Dr. Greenberg's presentation went through this really well, that there are so many great resources on the HINTS website. Before I start into any analysis, and when I was new to HINTS data not too long ago, it was really helpful to have the code book, the analytic report, and the methodology report, because just like I just showed you the weighted and unweighted amounts for those variables, that's provided in the code book. So, you know, if you're new to a statistical software program and you want to check that your codes are right, or you want to, before even getting into your analyses, want to understand what the distribution of different variables are, look at your items of interest, those are great resources to have up. Another thing that I generally do is when I'm thinking through a research question, I'll create a very simple, like I've done here, analytic framework. And basically that's just where I'm telling myself what questions specifically and hints I'm interested in looking at, what variables there are. And as Ali showed you, the questionnaire has the variable names next to it, so you can even put in, you know, for media exposure, what exactly the variable names are that you're going to explore. And so for this analysis, we looked at, as I said, general media exposure, which is just number of hours of exposure to these different media sources as they relate to addiction beliefs about all these different products. And we also have down here our kind of content of media exposure, exposure to information about the health effects of tobacco products. And then we looked at potential confounders, age, gender, race, ethnicity, and others. So first, I kind of explore the independent variable of interest. I'm starting here with kind of general media exposure. You can see here the question, one of the questions that we used on a typical weekday, how often do you watch television, listen to the radio, use internet for personal use? Some great ways in STATA to look at this is just the sum command. Summarize gives you a detailed output, which I've provided up here. The distribution, the skewness, the mean, the median. Another great way to look at a specific variable is histogram. So you can see kind of this variable and the continuous variable of watching TV is pretty skewed. I did want to say, too, I'm providing snapshots of my do file here. Hopefully they'll be helpful. And then when I type commands in the PowerPoint, you'll see that I italicize it. That's not for any particular reason other than to show you that it's a command. So don't think that STATA needs that. You can type them however you want. So then, you know, we looked at kind of just continuous variables of media exposure, and we thought, well, let's go ahead and combine those. Let's just look at like average media exposure to each of these three sources on a typical weekend and weekday. So these are the two questions we used. And then in STATA, if you want to create an average, you basically just generate a new variable and add the two together, divide by two, you know, create a very simple average. In looking at the distribution for this, it was still heavily skewed, so I decided to log transform it. And then I actually decided to drop 32 extreme outliers. This is the resulting histogram of the continuous variable that was created, so much more normally distributed, as you'll note there. In addition to looking at media exposure continuously, we thought, well, you know, let's see if we can break that into two. One estimate we found showed that the average American is exposed to 11 hours of different types of media, so let's break it at two. These are the commands I use to do that, and this is the output. So you can see kind of the breakdown of number of respondents that were exposed to more than 11 or less than 11. So now we talked about kind of our key independent variable of media exposure. Let's talk about the dependent variables. So again, reminding you of the question that we used, we looked at addictive beliefs about all these different products. We had several dependent variables. You can see the variable names here, addictive cigarettes. We had addictive beliefs about e-cigarettes. It was a four-point scale here. And so you can see the responses were very addictive, moderately addictive, not at all, and don't know. And so we decided in exploring this variable to also create a two-category variable, which is what I'm doing here. So we combined the categories of not at all and don't know with very and moderately addictive. And then we used kind of the codebook command. That's another great STATA command to kind of make sure that the variables you're creating actually are what you intended to create. And then, of course, after we kind of visually explored both the independent and dependent variables, you want to start descriptively exploring the relationship between those two variables. So this is just a very simple bar chart in STATA where I looked at the four category dependent variable by media exposure. And this is the continuous media exposure variable. And you can see that there's not much difference in terms of media exposure. And then we looked at this relationship in a 2x2 or using a chi-square test or cross-tabs, another way I've heard it called, there's not much difference here in terms of media exposure and addiction beliefs. Another kind of helpful STATA tip that I really like to use is this for each command. If you're looking at a lot of different variables, for each basically tells STATA to, for this second line of code, to pull in where the X is, all those different variables. That's really helpful to keep your STATA do file from getting unwieldy. So overall, we did not see a big relationship between general media exposure and addiction beliefs of tobacco products. But you'll recall that in our analytic framework, we were also interested in looking at kind of some of the content of the media sources that individuals are exposed to. So the question was specifically in the past 30 days, how often you've seen, heard, or read messages about the health effects of tobacco products in these various different media sources. And this is just a graph to show you all of the different sources that were asked in the question. So you know, we have news websites, government websites, and this is the proportion of respondents that said that they were exposed to tobacco use health effects messages. Never, a couple times, a lot of times in each of these different sources. So you can see for television actually was one where the proportion was greater for those that said, you know, we saw a lot of times or a couple of times these messages on television. We decided also in looking at the literature to see if it would be meaningful to compare these media sources or condense them into active and passive media. So media types where users would have to actively engage like social media or health websites as opposed to passive sources where they're just being exposed to it. We did find differences that you'll see in the subsequent manuscripts, and I can talk through after if those of you are interested, between the categorizations of active and media sources with different tobacco products. So just to give you one set of results, respondents that had seen or heard these messages about health effects of tobacco use on active media channels, so that's like websites or social media, had 1.5 times odds of believing that smokeless tobacco, hookah, and roll your own cigarettes are addictive, compared to respondents that weren't exposed to tobacco use health effects in these venues. So, and one final note, you notice before I provided a simple bar graph that was STATA visual graphics, which are, in my opinion, somewhat poor. They are getting better, and there are files you can add in. And the other graph I created in Excel, something that I find really useful is the tab out commands in STATA. So you basically can send your STATA output, which would appear in this window here, to a text file, and then you can select all and copy and paste into Excel and make beautiful tables and Excel figures, which I think is very helpful. But in summary, this is just a quick snapshot of an analysis that's ongoing, but HINTS-FDA offers a great nationally representative data set to examine both these questions around health information seeking and beliefs, media exposure as we were looking at and the content of that exposure with beliefs about tobacco product claims. STATA, as was mentioned in other programs, is a great option for analyzing these data. There is a lot of code already in the analytic resources, and I'm sure there will only become more as more people access these data using STATA. And so it's a great resource, and here I've provided just examples of how to construct and consider different analyses in STATA, but of course there are lots more that you can do with these data, and the questionnaire, as you'll see soon when it becomes public, is really rich for the HINTS-FDA data. So here's my information. I'm happy to answer questions now or later. Thanks so much. So I didn't know, do you want me to answer questions now? Okay, we'll answer questions at the end. Thanks.